sleep.
Yep.
I was trying to put you to sleep, but now we're just going to sneak out. So, my name is John Rice. That's from the Ojibwe, the ancestor who the name Rice comes from. His name was Menominee, and he was a wild rice farmer. So Menominee meant someone who looks after the wild rice. And we came from Wisconsin a few generations ago. And when we landed here in Ontario, we actually settled in Lake Muskoka. That was our resource gathering area. I kind of wish we still owned that. So what Menominee did was he was one of the last traditional people to move on Perry Island, which at that time was called Perry Island Indian Reserve number 16. And he moved there with his family. And what happened to him then was he Christianized, and we became Rices. And the name John Rice in my family is a popular name. I'm actually John Rice III. And they became lay ministers in their lifetimes. So they helped out in the local United Church as lay ministers. And what happened for them, that's the way it was. We Christianized. But being of a younger generation, when I was young, I've heard all the stories about how we used to be. My grandmother, my maternal grandmother, told me stories about our teachings, about how to conduct myself and all of these things. Even my own mother, who later on in her life became a United Church minister. Some of you might remember her. Her name was Aileen Rice. She became a United Church minister, and that's what she did, to keep the church going in our community. But as children, when we were younger, my sisters and I, we approached her and we told her we wanted to return to the old way. And at first, my mother was reluctant to even hear that. And she discouraged us. But around the time I turned 20, it became firm within me that that's what I had to do, return to the original ways that our people followed. So I told her I was going to do that. I was going to become Manawan. And at that time, she gave me the wisest advice anybody could hear when you're considering your faith. She said to me, okay, if you go that road, she said, it's not an easy road. Any faith isn't an easy road. You're going to run into trouble. You're going to run into hardship. She said, if you run into a hard time becoming this Manawan, she said, don't get mad and become Christian again. She said, follow that road. She said, it's not a simple thing or a trivial thing you're considering. So that advice was really good, because there were times when I wondered about our old ways. But those hard times within our faith, her words helped me through, especially during this time when we think about what happened historically to our belief system, our culture, and our ways of being. It was very difficult from time to time to consider even my own personal understanding of things. There were new things I had to learn. There were new places I had to put my thinking that I didn't have when I was a child. And one of the biggest things actually was inclusiveness, including everybody, that everybody had a right to existence. Everybody had a right to believe what they believed. That was a major understanding that I had to learn. So, what's happening now, in this day and age, with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, going around and hearing stories of people who are in the residential schools, listening to those painful stories and seeing the healing happening now that people have voice, is an important thing. Because the voice is very important. In my childhood, I heard many stories. Family stories, those things were freely given to me. And I understood things that were nowhere in the public school education. When I went to town school, there was nothing about us in their teachings. Even when I learned, as I was becoming an activist and more politically inclined, there was nothing about us in the Canadian political system. It was like this was no voice for us. Our voice had been quieted. And even as people, we had adopted that too. You've heard of that saying, eh? Indian people are a proud, taciturn, noble savage.
What a thing to say.
And for my lifetime, I actually even tried to fulfill that, eh? I prided myself on being the big, strong, silent type. So, and there's this picture, the symbolism of that old Indian warrior with one tear running down his cheek. Mm-hmm. I practiced that. I always just got both eyes tearing at the same time. I don't know how that old guy did it, but somehow he mastered that. So basically what we were doing in many levels, we were being told to be quiet. We were told to shut up. We were told, your voice has no say in this country. And we bought into that a little bit ourselves as people. So one of the greatest things that happened to us when we started recovering our culture was learning, yeah, we do have a voice, and we do have a right to say our culture. And in all honesty, some people want to talk about their pain and their suffering. That's what they need to do. There are other people who want to talk about the glory and the way we were at one time. And those two stories go hand in hand. Because after the pain and the suffering happens and the healing is done, where would people turn? They would turn to remembering how we used to be. How it was what they call pre-contact. And that's where I went. I went to that place to hear those stories about how we used to be and how we used to conduct ourselves. Our social structures, our language, our family dynamics is where I went. And for me, that was a positive route. And it helped me have a more optimistic outlook to this current time. But before I start talking about how we got to be here as people in Central Ontario, there's one thing I learned recently. Not only were we made to be quiet, but within the Canadian culture,
everybody.
When the Department of Indian Affairs was doing its utmost to eradicate us from the face of Canadian picture, there were friendship societies out there. There were non-native people who befriended us through what were called friendship societies. And there's a friend of mine from Cape Corker, his name is Wilmer Najwan, who talks about that. He says that there was this club down in Toronto. It was called the Indian Eskimo Club. Didn't belong to Indians or Eskimos. So they were people who supported the chiefs. Back before chiefs started getting money to have chiefs meetings, chiefs used to walk to meetings. They used to work out of pocket. They were very humble people. And you would hear stories of people from my community walking to North Bay, walking to Toronto. And they would get to these places, our leaders, and these Indian Eskimo people would be there. If someone had to speak to someone representative from the Minister of Indian Affairs, he would go there and these people would hear he was going to be there, and then they would show up and they would sit in this meeting room with the government official. And the chief would speak what he wanted for his community. And the government official, being bureaucratic, would delay his response. Very often these people would stand up behind this man and say, or this woman, and say, that's not right. And when the government agent asked, who are you to speak? This person very often would be a prominent Toronto citizen, there to support morally our chiefs. So those were what friendship societies did for us. And they were in existence for a long time. There were people who didn't agree with the way First Nations people were being treated. And they created that element in the Canadian structure, friendship societies. But the Canadian government told them to shut up too. And those ones became quiet also. So that created a great void in our understanding of First Nations people in this community. Not only could we not talk about ourselves, but other people couldn't talk about us. That's why there's such a great ignorance about the way we are and the way we used to be, because of that policy that was implemented by the Canadian government. The very same thing happened down in the Americans, down in the States too. So that always reminds me, because I work in education, from Barbara Colarasso wrote up her book, The Bullied and the Bystander. That whole principle. So, I'm going to talk a little bit about here, Central Ontario, give you a little bit of understanding in the history of the people here. Yeah, this is Wendat territory. It is. But I can't speak Wendat. In fact, what happened during the fur trade, it created a warfare between First Nations in North America. For the first time, we were fighting over something that was materialistic. So here in this part of the area, the people from the south came up here to harvest furs. And they created this disturbance that eventually forced the Wendat to move to Quebec. And some of them moved to the southwest and in the States. So the Wendats, they know the Ojibwe's live here now, right? They know this is where we live. So they say that about us, eh? Yeah, the Ojibwe's can be there for now. They can take care of it till we get back. So this is Anishinaabe territory, Ojibwe territory. And that term Anishinaabe isn't just confined to the Ojibwe people, right? The people who call Odawa, Potawatomi, Ojibwe, even the Cree, they call themselves Anishinaabe. Winnebagoes, they call themselves Anishinaabe. There's a group of people who call themselves that. So this is that territory. We're probably one of the biggest linguistic groups in Canada. We're one of the largest language groups. So what we're going to talk about is how we came here. We're going to talk about migration stories and how this came to be, this part of the world looks the way it looks in terms of First Nations people. So one of the things before I start talking, the concept of nationhood here in North America was very different than the concept of nationhood in Europe. The concept of nationhood in Europe is based upon language, right? People from Germany, what do they speak?
German.
German. Actually, they speak Deutsch. They call it Deutschland. People from France speak French, yeah. And people from Spain speak Spanish. So the European concept of nationhood is based upon language. And that's what was imposed upon us here as First Nations people, was our language. They assume, because where they came from, a nationhood is based upon language. So when they got here, they would learn who spoke what. And so they would identify those people as having that language. And that would be their land. In fact, if we would think of Anishinaabe people being a country now, our country would begin at the Ottawa Valley. And when we go far westward to the Manitoba-Saskatchewan border, they would go south of Lake Michigan. Then we would go north to Sioux Lookout. So if this was a country we called Anishinaabe, Akim, that's how big the country would be. But that's not how we look at things. Because the other way we look at things is geography. Those of you who know a little bit of Canadian history know that Ojibwe's and Mohawks had a little bit of a scuffle, right? Just a tiny little bit. So what happened then, when we think about that, Iroquoian people and Anishinaabe people, we live in this part of the world that's called the Eastern Woodlands. If you look at the way we dress and if you look at our culture, you'll see a culture. Even though we speak radically different languages, you would see Eastern Woodlands people. If you looked at our traditional dress, they look very similar, is what you would see. So you would almost think by the way they looked, they were the same people. So you could say that was a form of nationhood. In fact, the Iroquoian people and the Anishinaabe people, at one time, we used to celebrate our differences. Just near Cedar Point in Christian Island, there's a place just south of there where the Iroquoian people used to build a longhouse. And the Anishinaabe people used to build a Medewin Lodge. And they'd build them side by side. And they would sing songs to each other in their respective languages, honoring each other. And they were saying, "We know who you are, and we honor that." There was no conflict over who was right, who was wrong, who was better. So the other thing that we used to define here in terms of nation was family. I'm a Bear Clan person. That's my family. An Iroquoian person who's Bear Clan, he's my brother. He's my family. So this clan family system, it transcended national boundaries, if you wanted to say that, linguistic boundaries. So within North America, there was clan families. So, see one of my drummers that showed up, he can come in. Nick, there's some chairs here if you want to come in. So what happened then, the term of nationhood was complex here in North America. Now, what you looked at as a nation, it wasn't just confined to linguistics. And that's the way it is, it was so interconnected. In fact, what we say is interdependent. You had nations of people who lived here who were dependent upon each other, even living interdependent lifestyles. And we talk about golden times when there was no warfare here in this great country, in this great land. They talk about golden times when everybody got along. But this is a shocker too, especially since so much of this modern history is based upon contact. There are some of my people who are blaming white people for all of our ills, eh? White people, before white people came here, there was no sexual abuse. Before white people came here, there was no child abuse. Before white people came here, there was no addictions issues. You hear that? It's not true. In our ancient history, we did things to each other that were atrocious. This is only one thing that has happened to us. There are many things we did before this time that you would be shocked to hear things we did to each other as people from time to time. Because every once in a while in our history, we forgot to hold on to the golden time and things went into warfare. We have stories that they say the rivers here in North America, they ran red with blood. These were times, ancient times. So we say that now, we remind ourselves. We don't blame this temporary time on one people and one incident. Because if we did that, then how are we going to heal ourselves? How are we going to believe we can be healed if we blame someone for giving that to us? Then we give them the power to heal us. And we will never be healed if we do that. We've got to return to our own ways and heal ourselves from those ways that we learned. So I'm going to speak about the first atrocity here in North America. The first real atrocity in this land. If you go and you see a medicine person, and in Ojibwe we call it his altar. He puts out an altar cloth, and his sacred items will go on top of it. So you'll see a peace pipe, maybe a drum, you'll see some artifacts, maybe the eagle, shell, the eagle feather, you'll see those items on there. And if you look at that, you'll see our history. Each one of those items has a creation story attached to it. The oldest thing in our creation story is tobacco. That's our first teaching. So if you look at our history book, that tobacco leaf would be the first chapter of Anishinaabe history. In this turtle island we call it. And then each one of those items you could see. The naming ceremony happened very soon after that. So our names and our language is important. All the way on down you'll see different items. The sweat lodge came to us when we were really messed up and it healed us. Right after the sweat lodge came the clan teaching, because after we were healed from the sweat lodge, we had forgotten how to interact as people. So the animals gave that to us to teach us how to get along. So all the way down, you'll see on a medicine person's or a teacher's altar cloth, you'll see our history and these sacred items. And over our history, you've heard stories of our pipes being smashed, okay? Our sacred items being burned. You'll hear stories.